The Debonair Club. It's fun and easy to build your wardrobe with our custom clothing service. There's no event that you can't own with a custom suit. Our top priority is to see your confident smile. The Debonair Club. Take the time to dress better.
Welcome to Different Thought, where I got that fire. Come holler at me if you want this Oxymile. But not really, though, because I have a wife.
Ariel Hayes. Yeah. Calling Ariel Hayes. Yeah.
And she's Puerto Rican, so that's not. What's up, everybody? Welcome to Different Thought Podcast, where we challenge the culture. My name is Mike Hayes with my co-host,
Ibrahim Wizards.
Wow. I wasn't even ready for that one. Say that again?
Ibrahim.
Ibrahim.
Yes.
Ibrahim who?
Moises.
Look, bruh, you just gonna be Ebro. God dog. That's
fine. That's a good nickname.
Alright, Ebro. Alright, we got Ebro with us. So as we always do, let's just keep this thing moving. So we're gonna hit it up, start off with our straight like that. I guess I'll start it off this time. I just wanna say this. Being well-read does not mean that you've read all the same types of books. Like, in my opinion, being well-read means that you've read books from all spectrums and you look at everything. So, yeah, that's my straight like that. Justin, what's your... I mean, excuse me. Ibrahim...
Ebro.
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 Ebro, what's your straight like that?
Mine is real simple. So, today I brought my travel... You know, my travel journal, you know, I try when I travel internationally, I try to like take notes so I remember stuff. Look back on the future and, you know, in the future and think about like, oh yeah, that did happen. So went on a trip recently and we had an uninvited guest. And
oh God.
We had an individual that decided that they were invited because they were friends by proxy type deal, and next thing you know, foolishness ensues and folks had to not swing on other people and all this ridiculous stuff. So if you are not directly invited to a trip, especially a trip overseas, just assume that you are not supposed to be there.
I'm sorry.
Assume that you are not supposed to be there. Like, don't guess and be like, yeah, we're friends, we're close, sure they'll want me there. Don't do that. Just don't do it. Just assume that it's not for you if you are not directly invited.
I'm laughing, y'all, because I know exactly what he's talking about. I know the backstory. So, whew, gosh. Anyways, let's keep it moving. So, take a shot for you. So, I'm going to start off again. My shot is for, hold on, Tavern Free and Martin Desmond Rowe. They are the directors for Two Distant Strangers. It's a short film on Netflix. It's got all sorts of Grammy nominations and stuff. It's starring Joey Badass, but it hits home, man. Especially right now with all that's going on with Dante Wright and George Floyd's trial and things of that nature. And by this time this airs, we may know what the outcome of that trial is. Mm-hmm. But it just hits home because, and I don't want to give too much away, because it kind of touches on police brutality. Well, it doesn't touch. It hits police brutality. But, you know, watching the film, and for me, it hit home for me because at the time of the Dante Wright situation, I was sitting here thinking to myself, like, what else? What else can we do? What else, as a people, as a black people, what else can we do to really change, really impact and have a real change? Because it seems like all the time we march, we protest, we boycott, but we still are end up in the same spot. And mm-hmm. I don't want to give the movie away, but it gives a twist to that too. So, and it was somewhat encouraging as well. So yeah, shout out to them. And I'm drinking Sincor tequila. This is where Michael Jordan he's one of the owners of it. He's with, I think it's four other owners. Jenny Buss is also a part owner of this. It's really, really a dope drink. So shout out to those brothers for making a phenomenal film, short film, and thought-provoking.
What was the name of the film again?
Two Distant Strangers.
Two Distant Strangers. Okay.
It's on Netflix. You should check it out. It's only 30 minutes. Hopefully it's as long as this episode of podcast.
Well, I am sipping on Chattanooga whiskey, local favorite here. Just trying to keep it classy as much as possible today. let's see, my take a shot. This is kind of weird. It's like a take a shot for one reason, but it's also straight like that for a totally different one. But my take a shot is like to UNC for doing the right thing by, actually promoting within, promoting the black coach, which I think, unfortunately, a lot of times, doesn't happen in sports when it's supposed to, having the black coach to move up. And, obviously, black athletes, especially in football and basketball, make up the majority of the players. But why can't the coaches represent that in a lot of spaces, in a lot of instances? So it was good to see that they actually did the right thing by Hubie and hired him as the head coach to take over for Ron Williams. The shot is, apparently Ms. Davis had a very interesting press conference where he made it a point to talk about his pride in as far as being African-American and being black, but then in the same breath almost made it a point to point out that his wife was white, which is like, they asked him specifically about being a black coach or being an African-American to get in this position, but then he made it a point to be about his white wife.
I'm proud to be an African-American, proud to be married to a white man, woman, proud of my mixed kids. Yeah. That's basically what he was saying.
Yeah, like, it's like this. It's like, I'm like trying to understand and give him the benefit of the doubt, but and maybe it's just because he put him on the spot. I don't know, but that's a weird comment, like a string of things to say, like, he would have to understand the context of this happening given the history of college sports in general. But
well, I think he was trying to belittle it, like, hey, yeah, I'm black, but there's more to me than just being black.
Yeah, well,
but it was an epic fail.
He was definitely tone deaf in that moment. So that's a combination shot slash straight like that.
All right, well, keeping this thing moving, before we get into the main discussion, I wanted to shout out one of our sponsors, ESL Clothing Brand, Empowerment, Success, and Loyalty. Go check them out, ESL Clothing, on Instagram, and look them up on their website. Order some from them, and if you decide to buy something from them, let them know that we sent you there, ESL Clothing. Moving on, let's get into it. So today's, So last episode was Trap or Die. I'm a big hip hop fan. Justin is as well, but he's not a fan of trap music. So I was more passionate. I think this is gonna be where you see Justin being going all out. But
we'll see what happens.
The topic of today's conversation is the code done switched up, or if you notice the line that I gave at the beginning of the show, the G code, and G is for G-code. Grammar, by the way. So
G-code.
We're gonna talk about code switching, Justin.
Okay.
All right. So let's start off with what the internet's say.
What does the internet say about
what code switching is? It says it's a noun, the practice of alternating between two or more languages or very varieties of language in conversation. I'm gonna let you give your spiel on code switching before we get into it.
You take a deep breath. I agree 100% with what the internet says code switching is. I think that it is purely that. On the surface, like, I look at it like this, like code switching. I just imagine, like, if I get dropped off in a foreign country, like somebody just drops me off in China today, I'm going to have to figure out how to speak Chinese if I'm going to survive. So I look at it from that perspective of it's a survival mechanism needed to survive what we have to deal with in America or anywhere for that matter. So that's kind of how I approach it. Now, I understand that there's a lot more to it from an African-American experience perspective, but on the surface level, it is purely a survival technique.
I understand that, but I guess my flip side of it is it's 2021. Should we really be having to survive. I'm an American at the end of the day. You're an American at the end of the day. An American is America is America is America. Like, I don't feel like I should have to change who I am or alter who I am to fit into a culture that is not fit into a culture. I feel like the culture should welcome me, because if we're supposed to be the land, if we are supposed to be the land of the free, how, why are we code switching? So,
can I respond to that?
Oh yeah, you can respond to that, because actually, it actually segues, because the next question was, is it really necessary in corporate America? So, I think I know where you're going with this. So, go ahead. Now, you know what? Say what you got to say.
Say what I got. I'm with you. I'm with you on, yes, we should all be able to be individuals, but at some point, we also have to be able to communicate effectively. So, if I'm sitting in a meeting at my job or anywhere for that matter. And it's me, old man Justin, I'm 35, and some kids start talking to me about being lit and camping and all this stuff in my meeting, I'm going to be thoroughly confused, and I'm not going to have any idea what they're saying to me in order to be able to communicate with them effectively to get whatever task we're supposed to get done. Does that take away from them being themselves? Kind of, but at the same time, has to be some middle ground.
So, I hear you. And I agree. I actually agree with that. I think that there should be a middle ground. But here's my rebuttal to that. I can go into the same meeting with Jimmy, Bob, and whatever you want to call them, and Susie. And, you know, especially being in the South, they can have a whole conversation where, and I know your stance on this, and they can say, like, things of the, you know, yurt or get her done or whatever it is they want to say, brother. You know, my God, buddy. Gee whiz. I mean, and no one checks them. But if I say things like lit or a, you know, what's up with that or anything of that nature, you know, that's black. You know, oh, he doesn't know how to speak professionally. And so my issue is with code switching is, I mean, I got a lot of issues with code switching, but it's, you know, let me be me if you can be you.
Yes, I agree. Because it's funny, because I have a manager, well, he used to be a manager, now he's up higher than that. A white gentleman, probably in his mid-40s, he would always use terms like, oh, they're just using cornbread language.
Exactly.
Right. So these folks get a pass if they decide to use some terms that are country or whatever, you know, to communicate in a professional setting. But if I decide to use a reference from my favorite rap album or something like that, you know, which I can do with some of my coworkers. I'm fortunate enough to have coworkers that look like me or at least understand the culture enough to where I can make those references and get by. Not everybody has that option. And but in a professional setting, in an open meeting, I would hope that my VP could be like, oh, well, he just uses some slang, you know, whatever. No, I ain't going to get that. And that's the unfortunate part about all of this.
And that's kind of where I was headed towards with this, is that, you know, it's so accepted to be one way, but you can't be the other. Like, it, you know, I get the professionalism about it and effective communication, but for me, code switching is not that. For me, code switching is fitting into this culture. So, like, we work in the South, and like I said earlier, you know, you can use any kind of country slang you want to, you know, yurt and get her done and what else?
I have not heard yurt, by the way.
I have heard yurt.
That's the first one. That's the first of me.
I've been
here for a long time.
I've heard yurt. I'm drawing blanks on things I've heard, but I've heard things and I'm going, they really are okay with them saying that. But if I say, I mean,
what's something Mike would say? Mike would want to say in a meeting. That's all I want to know.
Some of the things Mike would want to say in a meeting. Can't say right now, okay? I'm not gonna lie to you, brother. I mean, or for instance, I remember sitting in a meeting, working, and a gentleman kept calling me boy. And I came to a crossroads, like, and boy and son. Mm-hmm. I was young, you know, and I came to a crossroads in this conversation because I was like, wait a minute, is he calling everybody else boy? is he calling everybody else son? Like, these are the questions. Like, whatever the meeting was about, I don't forget. I was just like, is he calling everybody else boy and son? And so I had to, like, sit there and go. My rebuttal was finally, after about 15 minutes of this boy and son, I had to go, Angela? He was like, who? Angela. Oh, my bad. Mike. And he was like, you know my name. I'm like, no, it's got to be. Because the only people that call me boy and son are Angela Hayes and Michael Anthony Hayes Sr. Like, I don't know why you're calling me that. And you can see everybody like, ooh, lawsuit. And so, for me, but everybody was so okay with that.
Right.
But if I were to call him out of his name or mm-hmm. something, or call him son, or call him, hey, bruh. If I were to say that,
yeah.
Hey, bruh, what up, bruh? That they'd be looking at me like, oh, wait a minute now. What is that?
Which is a term of endearment.
Yeah. Exactly. My point. Yeah. So
that's exactly right.
That's my thing. Everybody was so okay with him calling me son and boy. But for me to say, if I were to call him bruh or whatever it may be, you know, it would have been a problem. Yeah. And so I would have been pulled to the side and said, you should really watch your language and watch how you use your slang in the workplace.
Right. Unfortunately, it depends on what, you know, what we call our culture comforts. You know, everybody's got this comfortable culture that they used to working in, living in, all that type of stuff, and everything's grand. Unfortunately for us, our culture has been chopped and flipped and skewed so many different ways, and it's viewed, and depending on what channel you watch or whatever, what radio station you subscribe to, black culture can be, because like you can listen to like a Candace Owens, for example, who tries to portray black culture as this like postmodern thing that everybody has these opportunities and everybody is truly equal, and if you're not, then you or something's wrong with you type mentality. And but at the same time, completely disregarding the past that led to people being in the position they're in today. And I think that, unfortunately, is the case for a lot of white people in this country, is that, you know, folks just decide, you know, the past is the past, and we're going to forget it. Forget how we got here. You just got to act right today. Mm-hmm. And that's the sad part about, you know, the G code, or as you put it, the G code and the G's for grammar. Because I'm a grammar Nazi. I ain't gonna lie. Like, when it comes to grammar and verbiage and stuff, like, I'm real analytical about that type of thing. And mainly because I was really bad at one point. Like, I hated English. I hated grammar. But then the more I got into, I guess, technical discussions as an engineer and technical writing and stuff, I realized how important it was, because if you move a comma, you know, a couple words down in the wrong place, the sentence means something completely different of providing direction to somebody. So in our line of work, we have to be really cognizant of those things. So that's why I appreciate it. Because if anybody, I don't care what you look like or who you are, if you come talking to me with bad grammar or writing something bad grammar, I'm going to look at you sideways. I don't care who you are.
And this is why I say, like, with code switching, and this is where I'm getting at, is that for so long, black people have had to code switch when they go into work, right? Yeah. Where white folks, just being honest, don't code switch. What I'm saying is that I understand where you're coming from with grammar, but with white folks, there's white people out here that don't use correct grammar. And nobody checks.
You get a pass.
They get a pass for that. And I'm saying, and all I'm getting at is, you know, I put it like this, man. For code switching, it's not just talking. It's how you dress. It's how you think.
Yeah.
And, you know, for me, it's way more effective. It affects my mental. And what I mean by that is, man, when the world was open and I was had to go to work, it was so bad. It had gotten so bad for me that I have a separate pair of drawers that I wear to work. Like, real talk.
You need to clarify that.
Don't get it twisted. I ain't finna put all my business out there. But I have like say for instance, I got boxer briefs and boxers. Like, okay, for work, I may wear boxer briefs instead of boxers, bro. Because everything about it was like, I had to change who I am a little bit to make you feel like I was welcoming. I was the safe Negro, but if you will. So therefore, you know, and you ask my wife this too. It's like, I would also be thinking to myself, like, when we have outings with coworkers, I would ask my wife, like, is this too urban? Because I don't want to scare nobody. Because, you know, but in with a cutoff shirt and, you know, a Make America Great Again shirt and whatnot. But let my black butt walk in there with a Black Lives Matter shirt on. It'd be, oh, gosh. It'd be, you know. You know exactly what I'm trying to say. So to me, code switching is more than just, you know, changing my vernacular and changing how I say things. It's also changing how I appear to you.
Yeah, your appearance.
My appearance. Because I feel like I only get one shot to make you feel like I can give you a chance. You can give me a chance. Mm-hmm. Whereas I see other people. Yeah,
Billy Bob would come up with the mullet, the cutoff shirt.
And they'd be like, make him a VP today. And I was sitting there looking at them like, y'all serious?
Yeah.
Y'all this?
Yeah.
So you know, I agree. Grammar is important. You don't get it. I'm looking the camera on this one. Don't get it twisted. Slang is, the workplace is not the place for slang. But that mean, what I mean by that is, it's not the place for slang for anybody.
Right.
We should all be using, the correct grammar and language, mm-hmm, as professionals.
Because you're trying to accomplish a goal on the behalf of somebody else. Yes. Or, you know, whatever your company is.
But my biggest thing over my whole entire life has always been consistency. If you're going to allow for this person, you got to allow for the next. Yeah. Just like with police brutality. Look, if you want to shoot black folks, just make sure you're shooting white folks too. And that may be controversial and whatnot, but all I'm getting at is, if you're going to, the same energy you're going to give us, give them. And vice versa. If you're not going to shoot white folks, don't shoot black people. Like, and that's it. So, like, just the other day, I saw something after this Dante Wright situation. They had something posted up with this guy, the 63-year-old man, basically tried to flee the police and had a cop literally hanging on the car, the truck, as he drove off, sped off, like burnt rubber and everything. And my thought process was, and it was a thought process of the post was, well, if this was a black dude, he'd be dead. Like, he would.
Yeah. And that's the unfortunate truth about, you know, taking it back to the code switching piece of it. Like you said, it is ultimately about consistency. You know, if everybody, if they can speak cornbread language,
I should be able to speak Ebonics.
You should be able to speak Ebonics. At the end of the day,
I should be
able to. And everybody's got to accept that. You know, if we talk about it, diversity and inclusion and all that stuff, that's basically what that means. Is it's like, if you're going to allow for this, you got to allow for the other stuff. And so, and like you said, if managers want to step up to the plate and control their friends and their buddies, you know, because that's, you know, Martin said, the greatest enemy to the black plight is the moderate white person. Mm-hmm. You got to be willing to step up and control your friends and stop trying to play around and act like you can't see this or you're blind to this. And I think it's a natural blindness because that's what you're comfortable with and what you know. The same reason why they let thousands of white folks storm the Capitol and act like, we didn't think we had police there because they're peaceful.
Yeah, they ain't going to do nothing.
And half the amount of people show up for other movements, and then all of a sudden, now we got to bring out the stormtroopers to protect the Capitol.
What was it? The lady said, I forget her name, but she was doing a Black Lives Matter march or something of that nature, and they literally had to walk in circles because they said that...
Yeah, they stopped.
If they stopped, it would be illegal. So, right. You know, I just... And we should dive into that in another episode about mental health, because I believe that this dives into mental health as well. Because, like I said, for me, I told you, like, I have a different wardrobe for work. Yeah. The year of COVID was probably my most productive year. And I bet you my supervisor will agree with you.
I believe it.
And it's because I didn't have to put on a mask to go to work.
Yeah.
I could do my job and not worry about how other people were going to perceive me, because I didn't have to worry about, I don't want to come off as the angry black male. I don't want to do this. Maybe make sure my hair is cut, because I don't want them thinking I'm a whatever they think when they see a man that hadn't cut his hair today. I don't know, a black man at that.
Yeah. Well, no, I guess I don't want to just leave that hanging because I realize the mental health piece of it is important. And that's really the core value or core issue with all of this, the G code and why it's important and why people who don't necessarily feel like they have to switch need to understand that is that it really is mental distress on the person and on other people that are different that have to constantly have to adjust. And now this is for everybody else. I think obviously you understand this, but I think the majority of people don't realize is that when you are in the workplace and you bring up something about somebody else's hair or their complexion or their, you know, something that they basically don't have control over that they're born with, you are causing mental distress on that individual because what can they do about it? What can I change? My hair grows kinky and curly. I might grow afro when I let my hair grow. Well, when I used to let my hair grow. But at the same time, when I was younger, when I did that, all the kids around me thought it was cool because I'm the only black kid in school. And they were like, Justin, can I touch your hair? At the time, I didn't think anything about it because it was just, I was the only kid with the fro, so whatever. But looking back at it, it's like, that was like a clear point where it's like, oh, I'm different. Now, I was more or less praised and it was more of a fun thing with being different then. But oftentimes now, it's a lot of people experience that I'm different part as a negative thing, and that's where it becomes a problem.
Well, it goes further, and then we got to get into the different thought. Yeah, yeah. But the it goes further than that. So I had the same experiences, right? Yeah. But the thing was is that I still was a little. I was different than the other black kids, kind of.
Yeah.
You know, my background made me a little different, and we're not gonna go into detail about that. Mm-hmm. But so then I became not cool, right? It's like you said you got praise for it. So, yeah, you're different, but you're not like this black guy.
Yeah.
You're not like that black girl. Like, you got this and that, so you can't be in that cult. So now your blackness is not cool.
Yeah.
Because now, you know, we have to downgrade you because, yeah, you're black and you associate blah, 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 this, and you check off this list, but this list right here you don't check off. So that's kind of where that mental distress started was for me was, well, dang, like now do I need to like not know my dad? Do I need to not like be struggling? Because
unfortunately, that's the expectation that's been portrayed for many years before us, before we came into this world.
Yeah.
And that's just, that became the expectation. Man, you know how cool I became the 1 week that I had cornrows?
Yeah, my parents weren't going for that, bro.
Right. My mom didn't really want to do it either, but I wanted to do it just to see what it was like. I was like the coolest dude in school, and all of a sudden I became the best football player on the entire team for no reason. Like, everybody was talking to me like that. I was like, what's the difference? But yeah, I thought that was funny, like, looking back. I was like, I just got great, like, overnight.
So let's, you know, in this discussion, here's my different thought is, and I think we kind of touched on it, is code switching or professionalism an effective form of communication, or is it really effective for survival? My take, it's all about survival. It's all about survival. And, you know, I remember I was sitting in a meeting with someone at work, and I remember this gentleman telling me, you should use a black card more. And so...
He's white, by the way.
Yeah, and that person was white. So it hit me that a white person would tell me I should use a black card more. Like, why can't I just move up the ranks because I'm a skillful employee of yours? So I'll let you get your take on that.
Yeah, I mean, I want to, and I've been fortunate enough to, I think, benefit from the meritocracy and that mindset, you know, in engineering especially. It's like, in engineering, you're right, you're wrong, you know, at least you're supposed to be because that's what the math says. Unfortunately, when you mix engineering and corporate America, it gets really convoluted because you can be right, but it's like how you became right, how you got to being right starts to come into question. It's like, I mean, yeah, you're right, but, you know, we don't like the way you made right. But Yeah. Whatever. So
it's funny you say that. I literally had a conversation with someone or my supervisor about that. Like, you were right, but it's about the way you said it.
Right.
Like, yeah. You shouldn't have said it that way.
But that shouldn't matter. Because I've witnessed other people say they were right in much worse ways.
Yeah.
And but still, they get a pass because they use a cornbread language. I'm gonna stick on that cornbread language. I'm like,
I've never heard of that term, by the way.
Oh, you don't want. And if you ever hear a manager say that, you need to run the other way because that means that they don't really care about you and who you are. And I got a whole.
I gotta ask my white colleagues about this cornbread.
I got a whole other thing to go in about cornbread language because that junk set me off when I heard that. I was like, oh, so they can do that. Not that my vernacular is like. Not that my vernacular is like super, I guess, quote unquote, Ebonics or slang, but it's like, but these folks literally, I cannot understand what this man is saying in a meeting, and we are trying to get work done, but they can do that. It's just cornbread language.
But see, to me, that's called part of code switching too, is you got to learn their vernacular. Like, I have a friend that we were talking about before this episode. I won't name his name, but he literally changed. How people, what to call him.
Yeah.
Because he was like, oh, my name is too hard to pronounce. And I'm like, no, man, make it uncomfortable. They need to learn how to speak on it. Because we got to learn how to understand the Southern vernacular. Why can't they understand how to pronounce your name?
I think it ultimately comes down to what position you're in. So if roles are switched, and now this VP that uses cornbread language is now a project manager. And it's the other way around. And I'm talking about things, and I want to be proper and clearly communicate myself. And I basically lay out that expectation that everybody else needs to do the same thing.
Till the spoils go to victor.
Yes. So you know, the winners always write the history. And I think that we are a result of that. And we know who the winners are in this conversation. And
is a different thought in it, too. Because it's like, the biggest thing is you got to kind of... It sucks, but you got to get to the mountaintop and then you can start changing the rules.
Exactly. And I think for us, and honestly, I relish in this opportunity that we have as, I guess, like, I call us pre-millennials because we like on the edge. But we like are this generation. I think I've said it before. We this generation that get to be a part of this like transition that our parents and grandparents didn't really get to experience. On average, I guess.
You know, like I said a long time ago, I can't remember what episode, but I believe like this generation is the generation. Because I think that we are at that point where it's like, we're not going to accept this anymore.
Yeah.
And, you know, basically, I said what I said. You heard me. Because it's just like the situation I had when I was like, hey, Angela, Mike, and homeboy looking at me like...
That's impressive.
He's looking at me like...
That's impressive because I honestly can't say that I would have been in that headspace to be able to do that.
So, but you got to understand, like, this was like after 20 minutes of being called son and boy. Right. And I just couldn't take it no more. Yeah.
I think the worst I've gotten is buddy. But even that, to me, I think I'm just used to that, just where I'm from. It doesn't bother me that much. But yes, son and boy, if somebody came to me with son and boy, I really would have to think.
Because when it first happened, I didn't think about it. Then he kept saying son and boy. And then the next thing in my head was, let me see if he called anybody else son or boy. Nobody got called boy. It was brother. Let me tell you, brother. Da 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 da. Let me see this. Da da da. And I'm like, okay, brother. Okay.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, that was a problem.
And then
that
was
a problem.
Then it came back to son and I was like, and then he that's what it was. I challenged his thinking on something. He said, well, son, have you ever done da 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 da? And I was going, hold on.
Time out.
All right. Let's have a coaching moment.
I think one point that I want to make, I think to really drive things home, is that it ultimately, because your final thought was, is code-switching or professionalism an effective form of communication? When the reality is, code-switching, I think, stands in its own category.
Yeah.
Because, to me, professionalism is just, you know, putting your suit, putting your button up, your tie on, or whatever, you know, being professional in that moment. Professionalism is more or less a suit or a uniform that you can take off and on. Code-switching is more of a mentality. It's a mentality, and it can become a mental disorder.
Well,
I feel like.
The reason I wrote it like that was I look at professionalism like, what is, tell me what professionalism is. Because as you said earlier, to the spoils go the victor. So if you're on top, professionalism may look different for you because you're on top.
No, you're right.
So I don't think that professionalism is this, I do think that proper grammar will always win and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. But I also think that whoever's on top gets to decide what professionalism looks like.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. It's just like...
And that's where I have the problem. Because that creates mental distress.
Yes, it does. I think... Dude, it's basically like if you own your own business and you you want to smoke weed, you don't care if your employees smoke weed as long as you get the job done.
Well, it goes back to the whole saying, you know, like for me growing up in the household was, as long as you live over my house, you do what I tell you.
Yeah.
And so it's the same thing.
So it's like, so is it unreasonable that for people or employees to have that expectation that people should bend to their will? As an employee.
And the flip side of that, I think it is unreasonable. I think that, you know, if you really, a lot of, the popular thing now is to be diverse and inclusive.
Yeah.
So if you're really about diversity and inclusion, you should let people be them.
To a degree.
To a degree. And you have boundaries. Like, okay, we're not going to talk about certain things. I guess.
Well, what you talk about is just the result. It's just people passionate about what they're passionate about.
Wait a minute, Justin. Because you have, I don't know if you have, but I have been in situations where there are conversations at work that I don't think that are professional.
Oh, absolutely.
And those are conversations that my supervisor at the time is having, and I'm looking at my supervisor like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
So that's my thing, is just,
you gotta be
consistency, baby.
I guess always what I was saying was, it's like, I think younger generations, because I said what I said, like, at some point, there's got to be a limit to I said what I said.
Yeah, no, it is.
You can't...
But I guess my flip side is that we got to get hit, we got to wake up as a society and say, you know what, just because they said what they said doesn't make them any less, any worse of a person.
Yeah.
You know, and then, but we also got to say, like, okay, he said what he said, but this person over here is saying some stuff, and if we're going to allow that, we have to allow this.
Yes.
So that's all I'm getting
at. Or you shut it all down.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
So, great discussion. Great discussion. Got anything else
before you eat? It just really comes down to, it boils down to consistency and people allowing space for other people to express themselves in the way they choose to, in a safe manner. I mean, just because somebody says something differently than you doesn't make them wrong or doesn't make them dangerous. And that's what people have to realize.
Or doesn't make them unprofessional.
Or make them unprofessional. And it also comes down to just, you know, at some point, the oppressed can't make the change.
Yeah.
The oppressed can't make the change.
It's got to start from the top.
It has to start from the top. So I think anybody who's listening to this, if you are in a position to where you can make that change, just recognize that, and when you see somebody that's doing something maybe different than you expect or different than you prefer,
try to understand it first.
Try to understand it before you stifle it.
All right. So before we get into before you eat, I just wanted to put this out there. You know, it's May, so you know what May is, right?
Ooh, shout!
You know what May is? April and May signifies, you know?
I know what I like to see in May.
Yeah, you know, it's sundress.
I can't look at it.
Yeah, I can't. I only look at one sundress, bro.
One sundress, baby.
One sundress. One. So, you know, May is sundress time. And it's also, you know, time to get dabbing deer, you know? So, you know, you gotta step your game up, because it's especially with the world slowly opening back up, you have your, you know, you have your day parties, your wedding. So when you step out, you got to step correct. Right. So, you know, if you're trying to do that, get your game right with, you know, Davenir Club. So we want to put a shout out for Davenir Club. Go check them out, their website and their Instagram, and go get you a custom made suit. I have me a couple custom made suits from Davenir Club.
I got a couple of custom made jackets as well.
You know, that experience alone, you know, getting your measurements and things of that nature, it's great. So, you know, just make sure you hit up Davenir Club, and when you hit them up, let them know that we sent you. Justin, excuse me.
Ebro.
Ebro.
Yeah, Ebro.
And It's Justin, y'all. Okay. It's Justin because they
go. Who knows what it's going to be next week?
Oh, yeah. Exactly. That's why it's got to be Justin right now. Whatever. Okay. Justin and Mike.
Let me live.
All right. So, before you eat today, and by the way, if anybody has never figured this out, before you eat, the acronym spells bye. So, we're saying bye-bye.
Deuce.
So, before you eat is on W.E. Du Bois' Soul of Black Folk. The Souls of Black Folk was written in 1903 by William Edward. Ooh, I can never get this name right. His the B. We're just going to say William
Edward.
It's
Du Bois.
No.
It's Du Bois.
No. The B. The W-E-B.
Oh, the B. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I can never get it, so I'm not going to try to murder that man.
Let's go W-E-B.
W-E-B, yes. Du Bois, better known as W.E. Du Bois. Du Bois uses terms as double conscious, which fits into our discussion about, the code switching, double cultures, applying it to the idea that black people must have two fields of vision at all times, citing that they must be conscious of how they view themselves as well as being conscious of how the world views them.
That's real as real can get.
The landmark collection of essays by Du Bois, a professor of psychology at Atlanta University, disputes the main principle of Booker T. Washington's political program, the idea that voting and civil rights were less important to black progress than acquiring property and achieving economic self-sufficiency. Unlike Washington, who foresaw that the steady obliteration of racial prejudice and discrimination, Du Bois paraphrased in the opening lines of The Souls of Black Folk, "The problem of the 21st century is the problem of the color line." As always, I challenge you all to go read up on Brother W.E. Du Bois, Fred. And of course, I always want to challenge you to think, do, be different. Thank you for listening to Different Thought Podcast.